Let's dive into one of the most mind-blowing images in modern astronomy. A single photograph with the potential to turn the entire Big Bang narrative upside down. This is NGC 7319, a galaxy not too far away. And right there, smack in front of its dense core, is a quasar. A quasar that, according to mainstream astronomy, shouldn't be there. We'll unpack why this one image, taken by the Hubble Space Telescope on October 3, 2003, is a game changer. Now let's set the stage. According to the Big Bang Theory, the universe exploded into existence 13.8 billion years ago and has been expanding ever since. The key evidence? Redshift. Mainstream science says that when we look at distant galaxies, their light is shifted toward the red end of the spectrum because space itself is stretching. A kind of visual cosmic Doppler effect, if you will, stretching the light as stars and galaxies speed away from us. From there, it's a straight line to the Big Bang. If everything's moving away, the universe is expanding. Rewind and everything goes back to that first giant explosion. According to the model, redshift can be used to calculate the distances and velocities of galaxies, giving us the data we need to compile the whole cosmic map. But then came quasars. These things are so redshifted they're supposedly at the edge of the universe, billions of light years away and insanely luminous. Quasars stretch the universe to sizes astronomers never imagined. And that's where the story starts to hit the fan. What if redshift doesn't always mean velocity and distance? What if that's wrong? What if redshift is telling us something else entirely? And that's where our friend, the quasar at NGC 7319, comes in. Let's zoom in on this Hubble image. NGC 7319 is a nearby galaxy, part of Stefan's quintet, with a dense core full of dust and gas. A core so thick it blocks out whatever stuff is behind it. Now see this bright spot right in front? That's a quasar. Blazing away with a redshift so high, mainstream astronomy figured it's over 90 times farther away than the galaxy itself. Yeah, oops. If the quasar is that far away, how is it in front of an opaque galaxy core? That's like seeing a streetlight through a brick wall. But the fun doesn't stop there. The astronomer Halton Arp looked at this image and found something even wilder. The quasar wasn't just sitting there, it was interacting with the galaxy. That's energetic material connecting them, much like the intergalactic filaments NASA recently confirmed. Arp saw these things a long time ago, and his paper on this is quite an eye-opener. He and his team showed this quasar is physically tied to NGC 7319, and that means its high redshift can't be about velocity or distance. It's an intrinsic property, the quasar itself, something the Big Bang and CDM models don't explain, and their practitioners don't fully understand. Now, Halton Arp wasn't a crank. He was an accomplished and award-winning astronomer, and the world's leading expert on peculiar galaxies. And he spent decades showing that quasars aren't the distant superluminaries they're made out to be. He consistently found quasars hanging out near active galaxies, often connected by bridges of material. According to these findings, space couldn't be expanding. Naturally, all the physicists and mainstreamers went back to the drawing board to look for alternatives. Alas, the truth is more tragic. When Arp's observations challenged the Big Bang, they took his telescope time in the U.S., and he had to move to Germany to keep working. Their excuse for shelving his observations? He had no predictive model to put them into. That's not science, folks. That's dogma. And Arp wasn't alone. Other evidence kept piling up. Ever hear of the fingers of God? When astronomers plot galaxies by redshift, they line up pointing at Earth, hardly what you'd expect from a random expanding universe. Galaxies with different redshift but similar shapes got bigger with higher redshift, defying expectations. And nearby active galaxies? Well, they're surrounded by way too many quasars to be coincidence. And that brings us to the next problem with big space. NASA just got direct observational evidence of an intergalactic filament filled with charged particles and connecting galaxies. This is the article on Nature.com. Of course, they aren't calling it what it is, a Birkeland current. But consider this thing to be a gravitational collapse along dark energy scaffolding. The article brings up an interesting claim. Quote,
filaments connecting halos are a long-standing prediction of occult dark matter theories. Here we present a detection of the cosmic wave emission connecting two quasar host galaxies at redshift Z, approximately equal to 3.22 in the Mu's ultra-deep field, observed with a multi-unit spectroscopic explorer instrument.
End quote. A long-standing prediction. But is it, though? Early Big Bang models, as developed by Gamow, Alpher, and Hermann, didn't have dark matter, predicted a homogeneous and isotropic universe on large scales, consistent with the cosmological principle. Structure formation, including galaxies and clusters, was assumed to occur via gravitational instability, but the specifics were vague due to limited computational tools and observations. In other words, they were predicting a giant explosion in a vacuum would look about how you'd expect a giant explosion in a vacuum to look, expanding outward from the center, which does not happen. By the 1970s, we started to see galaxy clustering by Peebles, and others revealing that galaxies weren't uniformly distributed, but formed into clusters, superclusters, and voids. This was not predicted. By the 1980s, they were calling it the cosmic web, and with the advent of large galaxy surveys, such as the CFA Redshift Survey and in-body simulations, it became clear that galaxies were arranged in filamentary networks, walls and voids, prompting theorists to refine the structure formation models within the Big Bang framework. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, dark matter was not part of the original Big Bang hypothesis, and was theorized into existence post-failed prediction to make the model match observations. Now, to be fair, dark matter didn't just pop out of nowhere. It's the ugly love child of two previous patches used to try and force gravity to do what direct observation proves that it cannot. Dark matter's dad was born in the 1930s, when Fritz Zwicky inferred missing mass in galaxy clusters, i.e. coma clusters, to explain their high velocities, which gravity alone couldn't account for. Mommy showed up in the 70s, dreamed up by Vera Rubin's work on galaxy rotation curves, showing that galaxies rotated too fast for their visible mass, suggesting a non-luminous matter component. Now fast forward to the 1980s, when the cosmic web structure posed a direct threat to big space funding, and viola. Someone pulled these two fossils from the archive and stitched together dark matter. Nobel Prizes were handed out, and the lumbering golem kept plodding onward. Dark matter cannot be directly observed. It's never been seen, it cannot be measured. Its current properties are exactly what the Big Bang and CDM models require them to be. So is NASA's observed filament a long-standing prediction of the cold dark theories? It sure wasn't. But you know who did predict these intergalactic filaments? The Electric Universe Model. Applied plasma cosmology with no made-up forces or particles. NASA's latest observations did not force us to invent new particles or adjust our theory. They just confirmed it. So are things going to change? If we keep pretending redshift means distance, we're not doing science. We're doing science fiction. It's time to embrace a model based around the fourth state of matter, plasma, whose scalability and self-organizing properties are capable of everything we observe in space, where the electric force and magnetic field shape galaxies, stars, and quasars, and give the cosmic web its shape, all without need for hypothetical dark energy or dark matter. Back in 1980, America's favorite astronomer, Carl Sagan, admitted that redshift might not mean what we think. And I'll leave you with a quote from his book, Cosmos, that sums it up quite nicely. Quote,
There is nevertheless a nagging suspicion among some astronomers that all may not be right with the deduction from the redshift of galaxies via the Doppler effect that the universe is expanding. The astronomer Halton Arp has found enigmatic and disturbing cases where a galaxy and a quasar, or a pair of galaxies, that are an apparent physical association of very different redshifts.
End quote. Sagan's acknowledgement showed candor rarely found in mainstream astronomy. He continued, quote,
if Arp is right, the exotic mechanisms proposed to explain the energy source of distant quasars, supernova chain reactions, supermassive black holes and the like, would prove unnecessary. Quasars need not then be very distant, but some other exotic mechanism will be required to explain the redshift. In either case, something very strange is going on in the depths of space.
End quote.